Lord, we just commit tonight to you, and just excited to have the ability to study the scriptures together, to be challenged together, to work through stuff together, and Lord, let us not lose sight of what this is all for. This is all for the aim of being able to minister the gospel of the kingdom to the people that you are going to bring into our ministry context now. In our ministry context in the future, be that preaching and teaching, be it counseling, be it discipling, whatever it is, Lord, I pray that we would keep everything that we learn in focus of ministry, and let us not let this be just a purely academic pursuit, but God, equip us and mold us and shape us to be able to minister the gospel to people. And so God, we just commit today to you, and just pray a blessing upon our time. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray, amen. Amen. I do have quite a bit that I want to try and get through today, so we may kind of breeze over a couple. I want to kind of hit some key things as we make our way through the rest of the first chapter, and use the first chapter to kind of set up the second chapter, because that's what Paul does. But yeah, we didn't make it through everything that I wanted to last week. So I know Emily sent out the slides. Did you guys get those? Did you get to check them out? Anything that, you know, we don't, any slide that I kind of breeze over, I'll send these back out to you on Google Classroom, or Emily will, and you'll be able to access all that information. If you have questions on anything that you see on the slides that we did cover in class or talk about, feel free to hit me up. I'd love to be able to chat with you, okay? But just by way of reminder, you know, four sections of the book of Ephesians. You got the intro, you got the doctrine section, which we're kind of at the beginning of. You got the duty section, and you got the conclusion. Really, we could say it's just split in two. First three chapters, doctrine. Second three chapters are duty, all right? And you'll remember last week we talked about verses 3 through 14. It's how many sentences?
One
long run-on sentence. So how many topics is it talking about? How many themes are there?
One,
right? It's one sentence. In verse 3, it introduces that theme. It's the spiritual blessings, right, that have been given to us. Past tense. They are ours in Christ. All right, we talked in verses 4 through 6 about the spiritual blessings from the Father. Does anyone remember what they are? Cool, good talk.
from the Father?
Chosen.
We're what?
Chosen.
Yeah, we're chosen. We're what? Then what's the next one?
Predestined.
Predestined. What's the next one?
Blessed.
Yeah, freely blessed or freely accepted, depending on how you do the translation. Right? Then we looked at verses 7 through 12. So we have the spiritual blessings from the Father. We have now the spiritual blessings from the Son. Anyone remember what those were?
Liberated.
We've been liberated, right? We've been what? Forgiven.
Included.
And we've been included. And then we went off on a massive tangent about being included, right, in God's plan. It says in verse 10, look at verse 10 with me, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one, and how many things? All things in Christ, both which are where? In heaven and where? On the earth, in him, right? So God has this plan that he has enacted to not only redeem humanity, but to redeem his creation. Right? And that is the plan. That is what we have been included into. That's the third spiritual blessing from the Son, right? I got one more to give you from the Son, and then we're going to get into talking about the two from the Spirit, and those will go kind of quick, all right? So again, spiritual blessings from the Father, chosen, predestined, freely blessed, liberated, forgiven, included, and that idea of included, this is the slide that we talked about last week. You know, having made known the mystery of his will, might gather together and want all things in Christ. Right? I want to talk about this for just a moment, though. And this is something that could take like the next 2 hours, but I want to make sure that we don't let it do that. Again, when we spent some time talking about this to where Jake was so graciously allowed me to kind of pick on him a little bit last time. And I think that one of my goals is just to help you try and reframe what it is that we're talking about when we say the gospel, right? Like I feel like so often just limit it to the fact that our sins have been forgiven. And like, don't hear me wrong, okay? Like that is so incredibly important. But that is one speaker out of the five sets of speakers that make up the surround sound, of what took place at the cross, right? And we have cranked that speaker up so loud, it's at 11, right? And all of the other speakers are turned down to 1. And so we get a very distorted view of what the gospel of the kingdom really, truly is. And so we need to turn down 11 just a little bit. Not get rid of it, because it's super important, but we need to turn that first speaker down, turn it down a little bit, and crank up those other ones so that we get a full picture of what is happening in the gospel. So let's talk about this. How many of you have heard of the fourfold gospel, or the fourfold division of the gospel? You ever heard of that before? It's something that Tim Keller, I guess you know Tim Keller is, at least. So Tim Keller, you know, he didn't make this up, but he's kind of one of the ones who made it famous. So this quote from him is, "The gospel is the good news that God has accomplished our salvation for us through Christ in order to bring us into right relationship with him." Sound good so far? And I would submit to you, this is what Keller talks about in a book called Center Church, phenomenal. But he says that that's where our gospel presentation stopped. Mm. Right?
Yeah.
No. Gospel is the good news that God has accomplished our salvation for us through Christ in order to bring us into right relationship with him. 90% of the gospel presentations that you hear, is that where it stops?
Yeah.
It's where it stops, right? The purpose is to bring us into right relationship with God, right or wrong.
Yes.
I mean, it's right. Complete or incomplete?
Incomplete?
I would submit to you it's incomplete. There's such an important facet that we forget, right? And I put it in red. And eventually, to destroy all the results of sin, where?
In the world.
In the world. Okay, so what we have done, I think inadvertently, and by some very well-meaning movements and some very well-meaning evangelists of the 19th and the 20th century, is we have reduced the gospel to being what forgives us personally of our sins so that we can come into a right relationship with God and live our best life and ultimately go to heaven in the future. And the problem with that, in my estimation, is it's very narcissistic. It's very much so about me, right? In that kind of lens. It kind of, and we don't use this language, but it really sends the message that, like, I'm so freaking awesome that God died for me and just wants to know me and be with me forever. Like, do you see the logic there? Like, the problem with that is, who is that centered on?
Myself.
I mean, it's centered on me, right? Is the Bible about me?
No.
No, does the Bible impact me?
Yeah.
For sure, but who's the Bible about?
Yeah.
The Bible's about God, right? And what he is doing to rid his creation and rid his world of sin and evil and death. Now, my salvation, right? My state as a new human, my state as a son of God, my state as a Christian has a part to play in that grand narrative. But the grand narrative of the Bible, make no mistake about it, is what God is doing to rid his world of sin, right? And that starts in humanity, and humanity is called to be a part of that process in seeing the restoration take place. So let's walk through this. Keller would throw out a fourfold gospel. I would present to you 5. I'm not the originator of this, but I think that if we miss number 3, we just miss 2/3 of the Bible, and it doesn't make any sense, right? So maybe you've heard this before: creation, fall, redemption, restoration. How many of you guys heard that before? Right? You know, it's a great kind of fourfold movement of the gospel. So creation, what God wants for us. We talked about that at length, right, last week. God created a world, desired for humanity to rule and reign over the world on his behalf, to create something out of the beautiful wildness of the world, right? God created the raw materials, put humanity there to go and discover and build and create something beautiful. We're all on part of that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, get public park, well-manicured, landscape maintenance employee out of your mind. Like, Adam was a city builder, cartographer, explorer, navigator. Like, he was meant to go do those things, right? We're all in part of that. We get that? Right? So God's purpose for creation was that image-bearing humans would fill his world and build something beautiful out of it, where they treat each other fairly and justly with righteousness and love, and that his rule and reign would be experienced all over the earth. How did we do? Failed miserably, right? Humanity decided to define good and evil for themselves, right? Ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, did not trust Yahweh's definition, And things have been chaotic ever since. That's why we live in a world of racism and oppression and nuclear wars and famine, right? And the depletion of natural resources. Like, we live in a gnarly world, right? Because of sin and death coming into the picture, right? So when we think fall, right, in our kind of like Western Christian mindset, specifically Calvary Chapel, we typically think of one chapter in the Old Testament. What do we think of?
Genesis
3. Okay, so again, I would just submit to you, I think we need to reframe it a little bit. So Genesis 3 is only the beginning of the fall, right? If we go all so Genesis 3 to Genesis 11, what happens? I mean, all kinds of people suck, right? And do a lot of really bad stuff. Like, remember the whole Noah's Ark thing, anybody? Like, what did God, like, judge the earth and literally made a new earth, right? Like, through the floodwaters, you have Noah come up. Noah is given the same commission that Adam is given. And we look at Noah, and we're like, is he going to be the guy that accomplishes what Adam failed to do? Nope. Noah fails as well. And then it's story after story after story of people failing and failing all the way until chapter 11. What happens in chapter 11?
Tower of Babel.
Right? And there's this rebellion in the heart of the people as they're trying to make themselves a name. And they're building, you know, I know our translation says like a tower. Most theologians think it was really like a temple. And they were basically ascribing as humanity that they are God. They are the kings of the world. And they wanted to define as a civilization what good and evil was for themselves. And so God judges them and spreads them apart. Like, that is the culmination of the fall. And if you ever notice how sharp of a turn the narrative of Genesis takes from Genesis 11 to 12. Like, how sharp of a turn does it take? Anyone with me?
Yeah.
Why?
Well, because it shows Abraham, and that's where his whole story starts.
So 1 through 11, yeah.
Oh, he takes them out of Babylon?
Okay, he does. He takes them out of, like, we call it Babel, or in Hebrew, Babel. I mean, every other time that word's translated in the Hebrew Bible, it's Babylon. Like, every other time. I don't know why we translate it Babel. You know, but so literally that tower was in Babylon. That kind of becomes the archetypal, like, evil empire. That's a whole big biblical theme that gets carried all the way through. And don't get me distracted because we've got a lot to cover through. But what I'm trying to get you to see, Genesis 1 to 11. Anyone have a guess on how many years chronologically that encompasses? Any guesses?
100.
2000.
What?
2000.
Probably the ballpark of 2000 years-ish, right? Methuselah, anybody remember that person?
Oh,
how old?
Yeah.
965, right? So, I mean, we're talking a long time, right? So, some 2,000 years, okay? From Genesis 1 to Genesis 11. How many generations? go read Genesis 5, right? It's like six or seven generations. I mean, we're talking a lot of people, right? What happens in Genesis 12? The narrative comes to a screeching halt, right? We've been flying thousands of years. We've been flying multiple generations. Then the narrative stops, like, so abruptly and focuses on him.
Abraham.
One man. Right? One man. And then the whole rest of the Hebrew Scriptures, the whole rest of the Old Testament focuses on him.
Abraham and Sam.
The family of that one man. Right? And so that's the third part of the gospel, right? So we have creation, we have the fall, Genesis 3 to 11, and then the dealings with Yahweh and his people, right? Like, if we were just to say that the gospel is creation, fall, redemption, restoration, the problem with that is we miss two-thirds of the Bible, right? We basically relegate the story of Israel to just being, like, moralistic. Hey, we can go learn some lessons from them, right? And we preach messages like David and Goliath and say, hey, go out there and slay the giants in your life by having faith in God. That message makes me want to puke when it's preached that way. Because that message is not about David. Who's that message about?
Jesus.
It's not about Jesus. Doesn't come until the New Testament. So how can it be about Jesus? Who's that message about? Who is the story of David and Goliath about?
No.
What's God's name?
Israel and Yahweh.
Yeah, his name's Yahweh. The story of David and Goliath, as well as every other story in the Old Testament, is not about people. It's about Yahweh. That's a very famous one. I can see by some of your faces that you're like, what? love the slay the giants in my life message. Hold on. Realize that it's not about you slaying giants in your life. It's about the fact that there is a very formidable enemy who is coming against God's covenant people who he had vowed himself to and he had committed himself to in a covenantal promise, who literally should have been wiped out and decimated by this formidable enemy. And yet God rises up and fights the battle on behalf of this little tiny shepherd boy who has no business beating this man of war, right? So that his people will be redeemed and saved, and so that he can make good on his covenant promises, right? So that message should preach, we have a faithful God. We have a loyal God. We have a God who keeps his promises. It should not be preached as, hey, let me rise up with faith and go slay the giants in my life in the name of Jesus. Do you see the difference?
Yes.
Right? It's not about me. It's about God. Right? It is about him. And so when we take out the story of Israel from the gospel, we're doing ourselves such a disservice. Listen, this is my conviction, right? And I'm going to place it on you. If you like it, cool. If not, Ron Burgundy style, send it right back. It's all good, right? But here's my conviction. We do not understand Jesus if we don't understand the Israel story. How do we do it?
Absolutely. He's the Messiah.
Do we get that?
Yeah.
Because what we've done in Western culture is we have made such a big deal of Jesus being God, right? We argue with the Jehovah's Witness, we argue with the Mormons, we argue with the people who strip Jesus of his divinity. I'm a church history nerd, Council of Nicaea, that was the whole big deal of what took place there. Arianism, right, was that the whole big, first kind of big doctrinal divide in the church. Was Jesus divine or was he not? Listen, yes, he's divine, but we don't ever talk about what divinity he actually is. Like, what deity he actually is. Who is Jesus? I mean, he is Yahweh personified on this earth. So if we don't understand that Jesus is the culmination and is the fulfillment of the Israel story, then we don't get Jesus. How are we doing? We okay?
Yeah.
Okay? Acts 2, Peter's Pentecost sermon, he quotes the prophet. Anyone know who he starts off? Starts off quoting the prophet Joel in Joel 2, I think it's 28 through 32. And at the end of it, he says, those who call on the Lord shall be saved. In Joel's context, writing, in the time of the exile, who was the Lord? Who is that referring to? Who's referring to Yahweh? Peter masterfully starts off with Joel and says, those who call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And then spends the next 12 to 13 verses trying to convince you that Jesus is now the way that we call on the name of Yahweh.
Amen.
Right? So like, if we don't understand the Israel story, we do not understand who Jesus is. Because he is the fulfillment and the culmination of the Israel story. And so realize that like the gospel message, the gospel of the kingdom, has to have the story of who God is and how he deals with his people. And that's what the Old Testament is about. Alright? And so, like, maybe this is the first time you're hearing this, but as you go preach and teach, please don't teach messages as if we're the focus. Who's the focus? It's God. It's Yahweh's plan to redeem and renew creation, right? And to rule the earth in partnership with his humans, right? So after the third part, you know, the dealings with Yahweh and his people Israel, we get to redemption, right? What Yahweh has done in Jesus Christ to put things right. And a lot of times that's where we stop. But we have to talk about how the world will turn out in the end as a result. All right? We call that restoration. Somebody up in here, why is it important for us to talk about the restoration of all things when we present the gospel message? Max.
People seem to care more about our issues than their personal sin issues.
Okay. So what? So the fact that God's going to restore everything, restore and recreate the earth, God's going to be a new heavens and a new earth, how does that impact that? Like what's the point? Why is that a message that we should preach? Yeah, what's your name?
Joel.
That's correct. Right.
I think it gives hope. I think that like beyond the redemption story and like, okay, like now what do I look towards? Like, well, now you like look towards heaven, and not only heaven, like what comes after, like we're in heaven together. in the world around me, like what all God's wanting to deal with that and how to restore her.
Yeah, absolutely, dude. Dylan.
I want to go off of like what you said with hope and also like a shift in focus.
Yeah.
Because like some, I know a lot of people that I talk to, they don't know what to look forward to, they don't know what's next, they don't know what's going on. So when you let them know God's entire plan for his creation and us included in that, then all of a sudden their focus goes off of just everything else and they move to like, okay, now I know why I'm here, my mission, and I'm able to follow, right?
So yeah, kind of, that's good. That's good, yeah.
I was just going to say too that what this does is it doesn't, for what it does is it takes our eyes off of the here and now and knows that, and it allows us to know that there's more coming, that he has a plan for the future. And that it's not just about right now.
Yeah, so I agree, but I also think that I get what you're saying, but I also think that there's a danger when we don't talk about the restoration of all things,
right,
that we just don't care about right now, that there's a danger to not care about right now. You know what I mean? Like I'll just be honest with you. One of the things that really is hard for me in Christendom right now, especially in Western Christianity, is there's just this sentimentality, and it sounds very spiritual, like it really does, but there's just kind of this message of like, we don't need to get political, we don't need to be like, you know, we don't need to sound like social justice warriors, heaven forbid we sound woke, right? We just need to preach the gospel, and we just need to make sure that people are saved and going to heaven, right? And hear me, like that sounds very commendable, right? Like doesn't that just sound like, hey, we just don't need to be bothered with all of that stuff? We just need to preach the gospel and make sure people get saved and hear the saving message of Jesus Christ. And again, the problem with that is we're just limiting it to the kind of substitutionary atonement death of Jesus where he died for your sin. And not the other pictures that you yourself read, right? Or those other four things that we talked about that the cross accomplished. And what that does is it, as Christians, we bury our head in the sands and we don't talk about what's happening right now. When in actuality, the message of Jesus, the message of the gospel, speaks to what's happening right now. Right? Like, oppression and injustice and racism and all that stuff is real. Like, it's real. I don't care where you sit on political aisle, it's real. Right? I got two black sisters who grew up straight up in the midst of racism. Right? And so, like, I've seen it. Like, I've seen its effect on them. Right? So, like, it is a real thing. Right? Now, please don't hear me as some kind of, like, social justice warrior, like, woke pastor. Okay? That's not what I'm going for. But what I'm speaking to is the fact that the gospel speaks to that stuff. Like it does. Because God's plan and purpose in the end is to restore creation to its original intended state. And humanity will live on this earth, redeemed humanity will live on this earth with God in partnership, ruling and reigning over creation for all of eternity. Right? And like the beautiful message of that is we will get to experience life on this earth the way that it was meant to be lived before sin and death entered the picture. And so as I look at all of these people crying out for, you know, social justice or whatever, and I hate how that term's been hijacked, but as I talk to some of my, you know, more liberal, progressive friends and they cry out for this stuff, understanding the message of the gospel, I'm able to be like, dude, my heart breaks for that stuff too, and praise God that he's enacted a plan already that's culminated in Jesus, and when Jesus returns, all of that stuff is going to be eradicated, and we'll get to experience utopia like you're describing right now. Does that hit home with anybody?
Yeah.
Like that's why it's so important that we talk about it, because it impacts the way that we live right now. And if that's God's ultimate heart for the future, right, then we should care about it right now, but with an eye and a realistic understanding that it's not going to be legislation that's going to bring that stuff into place. It's going to be Jesus ultimately in the future and his people renewed and animated by the Spirit of God who are living out the kingdom of God right here that's going to bring that into effect, right? And so as Christians, when we only talk about the gospel as the forgiveness of our sins so that we can be in the right relationship with God, in my conviction, we're punting on our inheritance. And we're just saying we don't want to go there because it's messy. I don't want to sound woke. I don't want to be a social justice warrior. I don't want to be labeled that, right? Heaven forbid that, like, you know, I'm not labeled a good little conservative and I'm not nationalistic enough and I'm kind of sidebarred or whatever, right? Sorry if this is offensive to you, right? But, like, I'm passionate about this because I feel like we have missed the boat on a lot of stuff as Christians. Because it's not just, quote-unquote, about getting people to heaven, right? Heaven is not some disembodied spiritual state in the clouds where we hang out with naked chubby baby angel play harps. Right? I know I said that last week, and I'll keep saying it's on blue in the face, because that is the Christian public, and even just the public in general in America, that is the mentality of what heaven is. And heaven will be experienced here. Because think about the Lord's Prayer. Right? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom what?
Come.
Thy will be done where?
On
earth as it is in heaven. That's what we pray. Right? And it is so vitally important that we understand it, because it impacts how we love people, how we minister to people, how we preach today. How are we doing? You okay?
Yes.
All right. So much more I want to say, but we need a few pages. All right. So, and this speaks to that again. This is the fourth spiritual blessing from the Son, is we've been given an inheritance, right? We've been liberated, we've been forgiven, we've been included in God's plan to redeem and renew creation, to get this place back to his original intended design. We're a part of that, right? It's called the kingdom of God. God's rule and reign being experienced spiritually upon this earth until he returns physically in the future. And this idea of an inheritance in verse 11, look at it with me, Ephesians 1:11. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will. We were just told what his will is in verses 9 and 10. What is his will? Look at verse 9 and 10. Yeah, he wants to gather all things together in Christ. Things that are in where? Heaven and where?
Earth.
Right? So, like, that is his intended purpose. How many of you guys watched those Bible Project videos that I sent out? Okay, three of you. Awesome. Go watch the one on heaven and earth. All right? So important that we understand it. Right? I'll give you a brief 30-second synopsis. Basically, that video talks about how at the beginning of creation, heaven and earth, right? Heaven, God's space, earth, man's space, were united together. Right? Isn't that what the garden was?
Yeah.
Adam and Eve sinned. Where was God?
Yeah,
I mean, he was there. Right? So God's space, man's space, together, driven apart by sin. Right? Brought back together in Jesus, spiritually, right here. Spirit of God, right? We're now in a place where heaven and earth collide. It's a very beautiful picture. But ultimately, where is Jesus coming back to?
Here.
The earth. So where will heaven and earth be in the end?
Here.
Back together, right? So it's this idea that is God's heart. Like, it's right there in the text. He wants to bring all things together in Christ. Both things where?
In
heaven and where?
On
earth. And so now in verse 11, when it says that we received an inheritance predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, what are we to surmise is his will? What's his will?
To gather
all things together in Christ, both things in heaven, both things on earth. It is to reunify heaven and earth together, right? That is like the basic storyline of the Bible. And if we miss that, we miss the Bible. Yeah.
I thought last week, like, you got all that stuff from, like, seminary.
Uh-huh.
And then I watched the videos and I was like, he got it all from.
So, yeah, I don't know whose credit this is to. Tim Mackey is a professor at the school that I go to. And my theological mentor that I'm studying under at that school was Tim Mackey's theological mentor.
Oh, wait.
And is actually on the board of the Bible Project.
Oh,
yeah.
Dang.
So
you didn't get it from seminary.
Well, no, I got it from the Bible.
Yeah.
I got it from the Bible, elucidated it, and kind of shown via seminary and the Bible. But it's all Bible.
Yeah.
I mean, it's Bible. We just have to understand that, again, as Western Americans, and when I say Western, I don't mean like West Coast, Best Coast, you know what I mean? Like, get Tupac out of your mind, all right? It's not like I hate Canada. You guys might be too young to understand that. But anyways, it's all good. Where my rap people at? Anybody? No? Whatever. Okay. Anyways, all right. When I say Western, I mean like Western, like European, like postmodern, like American psyche. All right. Like, we read the Bible and we have a lot of baggage that goes along with it. especially the first few chapters of the Bible. And I think we talked about this a little bit last week. Because we use chapters 1, 2, and 3 really as the fodder for debate with scientifically minded skeptics. And all we do is we're going to talk about the veracity of the creation claims, and we just skip right over the details of who God is and what his heart is for creation. Details that start at the beginning and get carried all the way throughout the narrative of Scripture. So I think there just needs to be like a laying aside of our of some of our like prejudices, and maybe that's a weird way to say it, of some of our kind of predisposed ideas of like what we think, and come to the Bible with a fresh lens and just let it speak for itself. Because when we do that, we start to see this beautiful picture. We're like, wow, the Bible's not about me. And it's not about God dying for me so I can be in a relationship with him. The Bible is about God reunifying heaven and earth, and that has its effect on me because I'm a human that lives on earth. Does that make sense? Bible, who's the Bible about? Who's the Bible not about?
Me.
One more time. Who's the Bible about?
God.
Yeah, who's the Bible not about?
Me.
So listen. Oh, I'm going to not get distracted. Okay, I'm just going to
do it.
Don't. Okay, I'm literally just going to say it. Okay. Do not. Again, I'm talking to students who are going to go be preachers and teachers of God's word. If you ever reduce God to a peripheral character or Jesus to a peripheral character in your sermon, rethink your vocation. You get what I'm saying?
No.
You get what I'm saying there?
No.
So I heard a sermon not too long ago. I'm not going to say who, but I heard a sermon not too long ago about the three friends of the paralytic that, you know, ripped apart the ceiling, ripped apart the roof to lower the paralytic down to be, you know, healed by Jesus, right? You guys familiar with that story? It says all three of the Sunday Gospels. And, you know, Jesus says, hey, arise, take up your bed and walk, right? This whole day, right? Rise, get up and walk. And then all the Pharisees just start freaking out, right? Or no, sorry, that's not true. Hold on. The story is, Jesus says, son, your sins are forgiven,
yeah.
Right? Was that a bomb that was dropped?
Yeah.
Oh, for sure. How did the Pharisees respond?
Only God.
Yeah, who is this? Only God can forgive sins. And Jesus is like, oh, okay, but so you know that I have the ability to forgive sins? Hey, fool, get up and walk. You know what I mean? Like, what was Jesus doing?
Proving himself.
That was Jesus' public announcement of like, yo, I'm here. Like, what's he been preaching and teaching all the way up until that point? Repent, for the kingdom of God is what?
Here.
At hand. It's near. He says, I'm the king. Like, I'm here. And that story is him saying, this is who I am. Beyond the shadow of a doubt, let me prove it to you, suckers. And I heard a message recently that was focused on the three friends. And the message was persistent faith. We're going to learn lessons, three lessons about persistent faith from the friends. And the end of the sermon got to the part where Jesus talked about the forgiveness of sins and talked about arise, get up and walk. And it was just kind of mentioned and glossed over. Jesus was reduced to a secondary character in that sermon.
Mm-hmm.
Who was the focus on?
Jesus.
No, the focus was on the friends. Who was not the focus of that sermon?
Jesus.
Who's the point of that sermon? Or who's the point of that text? Yeah, it's Jesus. There you're like, I don't know if I see y'all here, Jesus. I mean, it's the New Testament, it's Jesus. Right? It's Jesus. Right? So like we need to preach gospel-centered sermons. Gospel-centered sermons are not the ones that you know are super helpful. And it's like, here's four principles for living in faith, or you know, here's four ways to overcome addiction or whatever. Like, gospel-centered sermons are, this is who God is, this is what he's doing to redeem his world. And this is the effect that it has on us as redeemed humanity that live in his world right now until he returns to his world in the future. See the difference? Everything needs to be filtered through that lens. And if it's not, we're missing the point. We're missing who God is. We're missing who Jesus is and what he's done. Christian?
Yeah. So, do you think it's wrong to point out that fact, though, right? That the four friends.
Oh, I think it's
right,
awesome.
I think that's
right. It's there. Let's use it. But it's not the point.
It's not the point.
What's the point? I mean, Jesus is the point, right?
Yeah.
Jesus is making the announcement that, hey, repent, for the kingdom of God's at hand. Everyone would have known what that meant. Everyone would have known the prophecies of 2 Samuel 6 and 7, you know, the Davidic covenant. They would have known Isaiah 6, Isaiah 11, right? They would have known, Ezekiel 38. They would have known, hey, there's a king coming, right? There's a Messiah. We're going to know who it is. It's a king. Now all of a sudden, Jesus is coming up and saying, hey, the kingdom's here. The implication is, I'm the king, right? And then now, a couple chapters later, he's healing a paralytic and saying, your sins are forgiven. Let me prove to you that I have the ability to forgive sins. Oh, yeah, hey, basically, that means I'm God. You know what I mean? Like, if we miss that, we miss the point. You're doing good? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So, all that to say, go watch those Bible Project videos. Alright? And you'll hopefully either A, think I'm not a heretic, or B, have a lot of ammunition to think I'm a heretic. but it's just so reshaping. And in my mind, it helps us make sense of the world that we live in. Alright? Like, Christianity is the story of the Bible is the only thing in my mind that really deals with the problem of sin and evil in our world. It is. It's the only answer for what we have going on in our world that we've all experienced and that we've all felt the effects of. Because the story of the Bible is that one day it will be eradicated and dealt with. Right? Like, is that not landing? Like, that is the great hope of the message of the Bible, is that evil will be done away with from this world that we live in. We get to live here without it. Sounds so rad. You know what I mean? So, hold on. Yeah. What's your name?
Josh.
Josh, go for it, dude.
So, I'm just having trouble connecting the dots between there will be this future restoration, but I'm having trouble seeing how that impacts us now.
Okay, so... it impacts us now. go to 2 Corinthians 5. 2 Corinthians 5.
God, we're going to get nowhere.
Very familiar passage that I think we just need to read with a slightly different lens. Okay? Very familiar passage. 2 Corinthians 5, and verse 17, right? We all know it. What does it say? Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a what?
New
creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. How many things?
All
things, right? So I think that what's going on in this, and again, as you go on into verses 19 and 20, right, it talks about how everything was, so look at verse 19. That is, the God was in Christ reconciling who? The world to himself. So is that people or is that creation?
People?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, it's creation, which inherently includes people.
Yeah.
Right? So everything has been reconciled to himself, verse 19, not imputing their trespasses to them. He's committed to us the word of reconciliation. Look at verse 20. Now we're the ambassadors for who? For Christ, as though we were pleading, as God were pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. All of this is talking about the fact, to answer your question, Josh, that hey, there's going to be a restored creation in the future, right? It's called new creation. It's a new heaven and a new earth, right? What were we just called in verse 17? Okay. The way that gets spoken of a lot, and again, I'm guilty of this myself, and I've preached this myself, and I even believe this for the longest time. The application of that statement, you're a new creation in Christ, is this. And remember my context. I was a drug addict. I was an alcoholic. I was a liar, cheater, scumbag guy. I'm no longer that guy. I'm someone new today. Right? Is that the application that we typically hear?
Yes.
And listen, that's not wrong. Okay? Please don't hear me and say that it's wrong. Let me just try and give you a fuller picture. It's not just a statement about my past and my present. It's also a statement about my present and my future. It's, I'm a part of new creation now. Because where are we heading towards? new creation in the future. Jesus says, you're a part of new creation now. And then he gets into talking in verses 19 and 20 about how we're supposed to take on the ministry of reconciliation, be the ambassadors for Christ, to where we're bringing people into new creation because they get to see what it's like in us. Is that not landing? Like, people get to see what the kingdom of God is like, how God really intended for this earth to operate, how people were meant to treat each other in justice, in fairness, in righteousness, in love, right? People get to see that as they look at his people right now, animated by the Spirit of God, living as a part of new creation. Are we in new creation yet? Not physically, but are we here spiritually?
Yes.
We sure are. That's what the Spirit of God in you is
doing.
Like
a taste? Like a...
Yeah, it's. I mean, you could say that's like a sampling, right?
Costco
Christianity. That actually probably has some bad connotations that I have. don't trademark that. But Josh, does that help answer the question? All right, and that's our great hope of the future. So we should be living that way now, right? Like if the plan is for us to live upon the earth where justice and righteousness and fairness and freedom from racism and oppression and all of that stuff exists in the future, and God cares enough to eradicate his world of that stuff then, and we're a part of new creation now, then that should be our mission now. And listen, don't hear me. I'm not saying go be some social justice warrior, okay? What I'm saying is go preach the message of Jesus Christ that affects all of that stuff. That's God's heart. And it will affect the future, so it should affect our present. You are not just a new creation. You are a part of new creation. The part that's existing right now. People get to see what it looks like to live under the rule and the reign of God, hopefully, when they look at your life. Any other questions? I mean, this is so foundational and so key for us. I kind of slightly feel bad that we're not studying the book of Ephesians, but I feel like this is just so foundational that for us to understand what Paul's talking about in Ephesians, we have to get this. So I mean, how are we doing? Any other questions? Honestly, let's chat. Max.
Well, I was just going to tell you earlier, one of the biggest questions we get as Christians is, why does our world suck? And usually the only response we give is this apologetical question of, why does God allow evil? It's more defensive than actually giving away.
It absolutely is. It absolutely is. It's yeah, what about the problem of evil? Well, you know, God allows it, but he's not the cause of it. And I say, let's just ditch that whole thing out and say evil was never part of God's design for creation, ever. Right? That entered in because of rebellion. Right? Because of humanity's rebellion against God. Sin and death is here, and now God has initiated this plan from Genesis 3:15 all the way on to redeem his creation and rid the world of sin. So that humanity can live in partnership with him again, ruling and reigning over the earth on his behalf, living in fairness, and living in justice, and living in righteousness. I feel like this whole justice and righteousness thing is really messing with some people. Go to Genesis 18. Again, this is just not stuff that we preach, but I want you to see it. I feel like it's so important. And if this is the last semester I teach here, it's been fun. Right? Genesis 18. But again, my mission, I just want you to see this is the Bible. Like, it's just Bible. What's going on in Genesis 18? Someone help me out.
Abraham.
Yeah, totally. What's happening over there? Who's Abe hanging out with?
So this is the story where he and his wife are hanging out by Mamre.
Cool.
And three, God and two angels come and visit him in person and say, you're going to have a child. And Sarah laughs and his body laughs.
Yeah. So it's Abraham, a couple angels, and the Lord. Yahweh. You know, pre-incarnate Jesus, if you want, you know, to call him that. I would shy away from that, though, because Jesus doesn't show up for another couple thousand years. You know what I mean? So, second person of the Trinity, I don't know, whatever you want to call him. God the Son, I don't know. Someone shows up and starts talking to Abraham, right? And look at this, okay? So this is launching into the Abraham interceding for Sodom story, okay? So, verse 16, then the men arose, and the men are speaking of the two angels, right? from there and looked toward Sodom, and Abraham went with them to send them on the way. And Yahweh said, shall I hide from Abraham what I'm doing? Since Abraham, okay, hold on. We all good. We all familiar with this story of what's about to happen? Okay, Abraham's going to intercede if there's 50, if there's 40, if there's 30. Right? But I want you to see what Yahweh says about Abraham. And Yahweh's speaking to the angels. Right? The Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I'm doing? Verse 18, since Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation. What does that sound like? What does that hyperlink us back to?
Genesis
12, right? The Abrahamic covenant. Three elements of the Abrahamic covenant. I will make you a great nation. I will give you a land, right? And I will make you a blessing to all the nations of the earth, right? Three elements of the Abrahamic covenant. I will make you a great nation. I will give you a land, and I will make you a blessing to all the nations of the earth, right? So here we go. Since Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. What does that sound like? It's the Abrahamic covenant, right? Just without the land part. Right, look at verse 19. For I have known him. Literally, the Hebrew verb means chosen him. I have chosen him in order that he may command his children and his household after him, that they should keep the way of Yahweh. And then he's going to tell us what the way of Yahweh is. To do what? Righteousness and what?
Justice.
That the Lord may bring Abraham to what he has spoken. So what is the way of Yahweh? What is Yahweh's heart? Yeah, two Hebrew words. And I'm not huge on trying to make, you know, people like memorize Greek and Hebrew words, but for you guys, Bible college students, these are two incredibly important words that I would tell you to remember for sure. Tzedekah. All right, tzedekah, it's T-S-E-D-E-K-A-H. Tzedekah. Alright, that's the Hebrew word, the Hebrew letter that starts it is tzedek. And so you have to like put like a T before the S, right? Tzedekah. Right? Tzedekah. And tzedekah means righteousness. Tzedekah means righteousness. Alright? What is righteousness?
Right relationships.
Right living.
Right relationships, right living, okay. Any other ideas? We're gonna come back and talk about those. But any other ideas?
Right. Fear of the Lord.
Fear of the Lord, okay. What else? When you say right living, what is it again, Zach?
Yeah.
Come on, dude. Carriage. Oh, you're Zach. You're like Zechariah.
Yeah, Zechariah, my full name.
I just read Zechariah today. It's a really good one.
Yeah.
Some of the craziest visions ever. Yeah.
Holiness.
What?
Holiness.
Holiness, yeah. When you say, I think that these are all kind of going somewhere. When you say right living, what do you mean?
Like free of sin, like just not sinning, doing what's right.
Doing what's right. You said right relationships. What did you mean, Max? When you said right relationships? Relationship with who?
Everyone functioning the way God wants us to each other.
Come on, I've never even talked to Max about this before. Keep your finger in Genesis 18. Go to Ezekiel 18:1. You guys spend time with the prophets?
Amen.
Oh, dude, they're so right. I was always scared of that. Pretty incredible. This is not my normal office, so I don't have anything highlighted. Ezekiel 18.
What verse in 18?
I'm trying to find it right now. This isn't my normal Bible. It's not highlighted.
About the righteousness of the Father being on
himself. Hold on one second. I should have got my CSV. I want to say it's.
Alright, 22. Yeah. He's talking about the righteousness of man and the whole guy.
Okay, here we go. No. I know it's going to be 14. Oh, probably should have run my CSB. There's a full-on definition of what biblical righteousness is. Okay, here we go. So you guys can all see this? Let's see. Verse 5. All right, there you go. Go to verse 5 in your Deacon James. Oh, okay, interesting. They translate it as just. Not sure why they translate it as just. The word is seneca in Hebrew. So if you look at verse 5 on the screen, it says, suppose a man is righteous, right? It's the word seneca. The word just is the word mishpat, which again, we just saw in Genesis 18, right? So I'll read it with righteousness, because that's literally what the word means. Look at verse 5. If a man is righteous and does what is lawful and right, if he has not eaten on the mountains, nor lifted up his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel, nor defiled his neighbor's wife, nor approached a woman during her impurity, if he has not oppressed anyone, but has restored to the debtor his pledge, has robbed no one by violence, has given his bread to the hungry, covered the naked with clothing, if he has not exacted usury, nor taken any increase, but has withdrawn his hand from iniquity and executed true judgment between man and man, if he has walked in my statutes, kept my judgments faithfully, he is just or righteous. He shall surely live, says the Lord. What is biblical righteousness? What does it mean to be righteous? Yeah.
Treating our fellow man the way God.
Yeah, because what's the way of Yahweh? Genesis 18. Seneca Mishpat, right? Justice and righteousness. Right? Like, we've reduced righteousness to I've heard it said this way, right relationship with God. And again, that's true, but it's so much more than that. Yeah.
I can't remember which teacher was saying this, but godliness has to do with our relationship with God. Righteousness has to do with our relationship with people.
I mean, that is a great distinction. It's a great distinction. Because God is interested in how we treat people, yes or no?
Yeah. Yeah.
God had a vision for how his image-bearing humans would treat people, yes or no?
Yes.
How do we do with that vision? Naturally.
Bad.
Yeah, I mean, we suck pretty bad. Right? Like terrible. Yeah. Right? Okay, so we're in Ezekiel. Go to Amos. Go to Amos 5. Oh, we're on a prophet journey right now. This is rad. Yeah. Amos 5. I want you to see the importance of this. Amos 5, 21.
Do you want us to read it?
No, I'll read it. If you're there, stand there.
Yeah.
All right. Verse 21. This is Yahweh speaking. I hate. What does Yahweh say?
I hate.
Oh, dude, this is getting gnarly, right? Okay. I hate. I despise your feast days. How does Yahweh sound? Not stoked, right? I hate. I despise. Despise your feast days, and I do not savor your sacred assemblies. What kind of image does this put into your mind? Temple, right? Should put temple in your mind. Should put Levitical priesthood. Should put sacrifices. Should put the system of worship instituted by Yahweh in the book of Leviticus.
We just went over the woes today with Jesus.
Good. Yeah, absolutely. And he ties into this. Right? This is Yahweh speaking, okay? I despise your feasts. I do not savor your sacred assemblies. Though you offer me burnt offerings and your grain offerings, I will not what? Accept them. Nor will I regard your fattened peace offerings. Take away from me the noise of your songs. Yahweh, stoked or not stoked? Okay. Not pumped, right? Take away from me the noise of your songs, for I will not hear the melody of your stringed instruments, but let justice run down like water, and what? Righteousness like a mighty stream. What's Yahweh so pissed off about? What's Yahweh so mad?
Unrighteousness and injustice.
Ezekiel 18 imposes the definition of righteousness back into this. What is Ezekiel 18?
Definition of
righteousness? Yeah. Tell me about it. is biblical righteousness? What is it?
Do good to others.
Do good to others. Give me some examples.
Feed the hungry.
Clothe the naked. What else?
Feed the hungry.
Feed the hungry. What else?
Visit the sick.
Visit the sick. What else?
Yeah.
Take care of widows.
Yeah, take care of widows. Don't lend at interest.
Don't take your neighbor's wife.
Yeah, don't take your neighbor's wife. Don't approach a woman in her menstrual impurity. Great advice for everybody. Okay. It's Bible. Don't get mad at me. All right? This is literally what it says. Y'all know what he's talking about. Alright? But like that's the example of righteousness. And right here, the implication is that justice and righteousness wasn't happening. And that's why Yahweh's so mad, right? What were they doing? I mean, they were singing graves to gardens together, for sure. Like in the temple, right? They're studying Torah together, studying their own Bible studies. You know what I mean? They're listening to Craig Rochelle and whoever else, you know, famous pastor out there, whatever. We're listening to the people preach, right? We're singing songs, you know, the blessing. Oh, what's up? You know, that whole thing. Yeah, they're doing all that, but what are they not doing? They're not doing Tzedakah and Mishpat. They're not doing justice and righteousness. They're not taking care of the oppressed. They're not taking care of the marginalized. They're not taking care of and feeding the hungry or clothing the naked. Right? And God says, your songs? Your solemn assembly, I hate it. Because this is what should be happening, but yet you don't care. Because what's the way of Yahweh?
Righteousness and justice.
Genesis 18, right? The way of Yahweh is justice and righteousness. It is doing right by people. It is doing just. It is doing the right thing. We've reduced justiceness in Western culture to being a judge in a courtroom giving the bad guy what he deserves. But it's not, justice is not just giving the bad guy what he deserves. Justice is also giving the poor person what they could never earn. Justice is the idea of giving to someone who can do nothing for me in return. Yeah.
Would you call it more like treating people fairly?
So I think that righteousness is more treating people fairly. I think that justice, biblical justice, the word mishpat, right? M-I-S-H-P-A-T, mishpat. They're really fun to say. Sedka mishpat. It's really cool. Anyways, I almost feel like I have like a British tinge when I say it. Mishpat, the idea of justice is giving yourself for someone who can do nothing in return for you. Is that landing? Does that make sense? Let me show you an example of it. I think that John in 1 John 1:9 comes across this way. Go to 1 John 1:9. We're on the Bible tour today.
What? Is that
1 John? 1 John 1:9,
yeah.
What's up? Hold on. I want everyone to see it. Yeah. Mishpat, M-I-S-H-P-A-T, Mishpat. Okay, here we go. 1 John 1:9, if you're there, something there.
There.
If we what? Confess our sin, he is what? Faithful and what? Just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So let me ask you a question. How is a guy who never sins dying in the place of a bunch of sinners? So how is an innocent man dying for a bunch of guilty people? How is that just? How is that just? Imposing our Western American understanding of the word justice, right? Bad guy getting what he deserves. How is that just? Innocent man dying for guilty people. Yeah.
It's him doing something for us that we can't do for him in return.
Oh, so you're stealing my punchline. It's not just. Yeah.
It's grace.
I mean, okay, so I'm not trying to undermine grace, okay. But I'm asking the question, how is it just? How is it just? In our understanding of justice, that guy gets what he deserves. Justice in the courtroom, justice, right? I want justice. That guy murdered my daughter, raped and murdered my daughter. I want justice. Right? That's the context that we talk about that in. How is an innocent man dying for guilty people, how is that just in that connotation? Yeah.
Well, ultimately, the debt had to be paid. Our understanding of justice is like revenge. So, you know, we have that sense of justice because God is just and he's given us that. But at the same time, I think it's skewed in us thinking that, you know, revenge. judge is justice. And so I think ultimately the justice that had to be fulfilled in Christ was the debt that had to be paid. It wasn't necessarily that, oh, the bad guy got what he deserved, but the debt was paid.
See, I think we're getting back to the grace thing. My man back here in the glasses, what's your name?
Paul.
Paul?
Yes, sir.
Okay, cool. And Emily. Oh, I said that, and then I was so not confident. both of you guys, like, I don't want you to hear that I'm, like, undermining grace, okay? Grace is so, so, so important, and, like, I think that that's kind of the crux of both of your guys' statements, okay? Yeah.
I want to say, if the extent of the definition of justice was just, like, I want, like, Western civilization courtroom justice, if I was the one accusing that person, I'd be very mad.
Totally. And that's what I'm trying to get at, okay? I'm trying to say, let's do away with our predilections and our kind of preconceived ideas of the definition of terms. Again, I know that I'm speaking to, like, very biblically literate Bible college students, okay? Like, I'm very aware of that. But you will be speaking to people who are not biblically literate, right?
Yeah.
John Stott. You guys ever heard of John Stott?
Yes.
John Stott wrote an amazing book called Between Two Worlds. And it's the idea of preaching and teaching. He says, hey, as pastors and teachers, we live in the biblical world, but we also live in the real world. And so our first mission as a preacher and teacher of the world of the word is to build a bridge between these two worlds. Because guess what? We live in the biblical world. We're parsing Greek and studying Romans and all this stuff. People out here are living life not really caring. So our first job is to build a bridge and connect it. Right? We need to establish relevance. Why you living in 2021, why what was written by Paul to the Romans is important for you. Does that make sense? That's his basic premise for preaching. I find it so helpful. And so realize, when you use the term justice, when you quote this verse, I realize it may not be happening because Paul did it and Emily did it. You guys did a good job, like, explaining, well, it's grace. It says, okay, I get that. But realize, the terminology that is used in our English translation puts a thought in someone's mind. And that thought is bad guy getting what he deserves. American version of justice, right? Okay, so when it says that if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin. I've had someone ask me this question, how is that just? And I'm like, well, it's not just. But the biblical definition of just, the idea of mishpat, is giving yourself for someone who can't do anything for you. Right? For the benefit of the community. So read it that way. This is Jesus, the righteous one, giving himself up for the betterment of the community who can do nothing for him.
It's like the great exchange.
It is. And realize that it is the prime example of what justice is to look like. So who should be doing justice? Who should be about justice in the world? And again, don't label everything that, you know, left-leaning progressives call social justice. We're talking biblical justice. Who should be feeding the homeless? Who should be caring for the orphans and the widows? Who should be providing for those less fortunate, the oppressed, the marginalized? Who?
We should.
I mean, God's people should. Why?
Because he told us to.
He would do it.
Why would he do it? How do you know?
Because he did do it.
Well, he did it ultimately to pay for sin, right? But go back to Genesis 18, right? What does it say in Genesis 18? The way of Yahweh is justice and righteousness. Listen, this is what God is about. James 1, anybody who is pure and undefiled religion?
To visit orphans and widows in their time of need and be unspotted from the world.
Like that's not just like a nice sentiment, right? Like, that is the way of Yahweh. Right? Like, that is God's heart. And if we're not about that, we're falling into the same trap that the Jerusalem church did, or the Jerusalem temple and whole Levitical religious system did in the book of Amos, right? If all we're interested in doing is gathering together and singing and studying, and we're not actually practicing the way of Yahweh together and caring for those in our community who need help, who can't do anything for us, we're not practicing the way of Yahweh. Like, it's a very scary, like, sobering reality that I just feel like that we, as a church, we've missed so much, right? Yeah, right.
I'm just wondering, like, how do you apply this definition to the attributes of God? Like, if you say that God, justice in the Bible is giving something that we don't deserve, it's kind of like...
Not giving something that we don't deserve. It is justice, biblical justice is providing for the betterment of the community when it can when it really has nothing to do for you.
And then how do you apply that to the attributes of God and his justice? Because he's judging sin, and if it kind of derives from justice, I mean he's gonna bring justice to sin.
I mean he absolutely will. And so that's where we get into the nuanced definition of that term justice.
It's a different
term in Hebrew and in Greek. In English we only have one term. Right? So yeah, is God just in the sense that he will judge sin? Is God's wrath going to be poured out on sin? It absolutely is. Will he be just for doing that? He absolutely will. Right? But the idea of biblical justice, socially speaking, is something that we just don't talk about a lot. But that's what's mentioned when it talks about the way of Yahweh being justice and righteousness.
So is there two different words in the...
It is. Yeah. Right? My guy right.
Well, I was going to ask that same thing. Like,
okay.
When you read about like mercy triumphing over justice, that Greek word is a different biblical definition of Greek.
Off the top of my head, I don't know what that word is. You know what? We're going to get nowhere near where I wanted to get today, which means your homework assignment is going to be completely irrelevant until next week. And I so promise we're going to study Ephesians next week because Ephesians is like my favorite book of the draft, and I promise we're going to get there. But what I want you to do, and we still have like 40 minutes, so remind me at the end to unpack this a little bit more before I'm creating this assignment off the top of my head. But I want you in the Old Testament, that word pairing of Tzedakah and Mishpat shows up, it's like 200 times together. Now, they both show up individually, or all together, Tzedakah is like 400 times, I think Mishpat's like 380 times or something like that. 200 of those times they exist together. Mm-hmm. So what does that tell you? I mean, it's a connected idea. It's the way of Yahweh. Here's what you're going to notice, all right? Because this is what happened to me. Is the moment I was shown, hey, that's the way of Yahweh, and shown that this is a word pair, you see it everywhere. Right. Everywhere. It's kind of like, have you ever shopped for your own car? Like a new car that you want to buy? Auto Trader or whatever? You know, like, so we just bought my wife a RAV4. I pointed that way, but I'll park that way. We just bought my wife a RAV4, and when I was, like, looking on Auto Trader, like, I'm a researcher, so I was, like, totally nerding out on, like, trim, color, and all this stuff, right? Spending, like, just filling up my mind with RAV4s. See them everywhere now. Because my mind has been turned onto it, right? I, like, can't unsee it when I'm driving down the road. That's what's going to happen with Tzedakah and Mishpat. It's everywhere. King David, right? It's talked about with King David. It's talked about with King Solomon. It's talked about Messiah. Isaiah 9, right? Isaiah 9, 6 and 7, famous Christmas verse. Unto us a child is
born.
Unto us a son is given. It talks about how the government will be on his shoulders. Of his kingdom there will be no end, right? It says he will administer Tzedakah and Mishpat, justice and righteousness. Your New King James won't translate it that way, but the Hebrew word, the Hebrew words are justice and righteousness, Tzedakah and Mishpat. All right, so your assignment, I want you to find, I'm just literally going to make this up, I want you to find 10 examples. 10 examples, and again, it's not going to be very hard to do. You know, it's 10 examples of Tzedakah and Mishpat, and give me like a brief, succinct overview of, you know, kind of the theme, the biblical theme that you can see going all the way through. All right?
So when you were bringing that application or trying to be relative with people with the courtroom thing, you're pretty much trying to talk about substitutionary atonement.
Substitutionary atonement is hugely vital, right? And absolutely. Did Jesus accomplish the atonement for our sin as our substitute? Yes or no?
Yeah.
But is that all that happened?
No.
Right? And that's what's important for us to understand. But yeah, I think when we think justice, that's where our mind goes. You know, is to that idea of either bad guy getting what he deserves, or we go right to the place of substitutionary atonement. And again, I think that the substitutionary atonement of Jesus is actually a great picture of what biblical justice is. It's Jesus, right? Yes, God, but also man, sacrificing himself for the betterment of his community, humanity, and getting nothing in return. Right? Like, it is the biblical definition of justice. In my mind, it puts so much more color and beauty to 1 John 1:9. You know what I mean? Yeah.
I had a question about the homeworks. Do you want 10 examples? Where do you want them? Where both words are used?
Yeah. Find the word pairing. Find the word pairing. Again, it's not going to be hard. It's all over. Find the word pairing. Siddika and Mishpah. You'll want to make sure that you research the Hebrew words, the two Hebrew words, not the English words, because it doesn't always translate it as justice or righteousness. That makes sense?
Does BibleGateway.com?
BibleGateway, I'm sure, will do it. Lunar Bible will do it. Strong's reference number will do it. You know what I mean? But find it. Give me all the examples of where you found them, and then give me basically like the logical conclusion of where that theme in biblical theology goes based on all those examples. So you're like writing out like, oh, these are all the examples, and this helps me understand that this is what justice and righteousness means.
Oh, like as a whole.
As a whole.
So you're describing each verse.
No, Take all 10 examples, big picture, tell me what justice and righteousness means just on the way that
from
it's used.
The big picture.
Exactly. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That shouldn't take too long. All right. I saw some other hands. Max.
Dude, this gives me so much more color when it comes to Jesus' teaching on giving. Like, he clarifies, give and do not expect anything back.
Come on.
Even the heathens give much and receive much back, right?
Right.
And that's one thing that we suck at as a church is demonstrating that we're different from, like, morale.
Yeah, totally.
And maybe justice adds on to righteousness in that it's selfless.
Mm. That's good.
So, like, a lot of people can do good, but can you do it with justice?
Yeah, without expecting anything back at all. Go to Acts 5. Really, really the end of 4. I swore I'd never be that teacher that taught a book and didn't actually talk about the book. I'm so sorry. I went to Bible college and it drives me nuts. I'm very linear. Like, if you've heard me teach before, I'm very linear, and so this is so out of character for me, and I'm sorry. Probably not going to be able to sleep well tonight because of it. It's going to bother me. Ephesians pending next week. It's going to be dope. TBD. Look at verse 32. You don't have to tell me. Do you have any of those teachers who just ramble over it?
All
stuff? I'm so sorry. On behalf of Bible college teachers, I am sorry. Okay? I hate that nonsense. All right, here we go. As I do it, here we go. Acts 4, verse 32. Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Nor was there anyone among them who lacked, for all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of all things that were sold and laid them at the apostles' feet, and they distributed them to each as anyone had need. And Joseph, who was also named Barnabas by the apostles, which is translated son of encouragement, and Levi, country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. What's going on in the early church right now?
Social justice.
I mean it certainly sounds like socialism. I mean, let's just call it what it is. It certainly sounds that way, right? What do we do with that? Okay, I'm gonna paint with a pretty broad stroke here. Alright, pretty broad brush. Red team. Republicans. What do we do with that?
We qualify that this is they're on fire, and we say that they're really following Jesus, and it could work if we do that.
Yeah. We explain it away based on religious fervor.
Yeah.
Right? I would submit to you that this is the culmination of Siddika and Mishpah. Isaiah 9:6 and 7. So, unto us the son is born, and unto us a child is given. Who's that talking about? It's talking about Jesus, right? Government shall be upon his shoulders. Of his kingdom there will be no end. He will administer, what did I tell you? Siddika and what? Mishpah. What will Jesus do? He will bring justice and righteousness. What are his followers doing right at the early church? Right at the beginning of the early church? What are they doing? I mean, they're doing biblical justice and righteousness, right?
Yeah.
Remember the example of Ezekiel 38 that I showed you? Doesn't that sound like what's going on right here? So is this just some one-off random event where we're like, oh, those guys were just crazy hippie Jesus lovers and they just wanted to sell all this peace and love, man, let's just provide for each other? Or is this what was meant to be happening all along?
Is it what was meant to be happening all along?
I think the latter. I think the latter. You guys said you were looking at the woes, right? Matthew 23.
Yeah.
Jesus talks to the Pharisees and he says, man, you guys tithe mint and cumin. You guys are so meticulous about the law, right? What does he say though? But you neglect the weightier measures of the law. And both of those Greek words, and I can't remember off the top of my head, but both of those Greek words are used to are used in the Septuagint to translate Seneca and Mishpah.
Huh.
Jesus was talking about it, didn't he? Yeah.
I was just wondering, because this is a question of mine. Just looking at this, that new believers, they just became believers, you know, and they instantly knew.
Whoa. But this is different, because these are Jews.
Okay.
These are Jews steeped in the Torah. These are Jews steeped in the predictions of who Messiah was going to be, right? These are Jews who understand who Yahweh is. You know what I mean? So they're not new believers in the sense that it's some kid from Carlsbad that you just met and led to Jesus on the road to, you know, Tamarack Beach or something. You know what I mean? Like, who has no framework for who God is. You know?
So we go with that. They just had the revelation of the word and look at it through Jesus' love instead of through. I think more than it was that they, I wish you could, I don't know, I forget, but all second prayers, I wish is you that you, God's love, so you can have the wisdom like of saints and stuff like that. Like, so maybe they get a new revelation of the word. But we see this, but we don't see much of this in the church today. And then you see that Paul even says that we're sealed with the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, a question of mine is kind of off topic a little bit, but just because we're in here.
The whole day is off topic, so it's fine.
Yeah. And a problem of mine is the church looks nothing like the Church of Acts.
Yeah.
And so my question is, are we saved?
I mean, I certainly would never say that you're not. I mean, who am I, bro? You know what I mean? I don't know you. But from what I see, you got your Bible open, and you seem pretty concerned on if you're saved or not. So I would be like, chances are, you are.
I'm just saying, because like, I've never had any spiritual movement. I'm going to say I've never spoken in tongues or prophesied. I've seen, really seen spiritual gifts. And we said we're sealed by the Spirit. Your salvation is sealed by the Spirit. So where is that in America's church?
Are we getting off on another topic of like spiritual gifts and stuff? Or are we talking about this idea of justice and righteousness?
I was just wondering, like, I was looking at this early church, and you see that they instantly, well, at that time, they're like, you see a great movement of a new church is coming in, and they're having new revelations, and they're like, all right, we need to assert justice and righteousness. And for saying that, then you also
see I don't think that it was, and I'm sorry to cut you off, but I think I know where you're going. I don't think that it was just some random thing that they just dreamt up on the spot.
Yeah.
Where they were just like hanging out in like a worship time and they were like, dude, you know it'd be rad. You know what I mean? Like, we should provide for people. Like, you have the apostles, dude. The apostles were hanging out with Jesus. Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus?
Yahweh.
Yahweh! What's the way to Yahweh? Yeah. What was Jesus doing? All the time. Go read the Gospels with this fresh lens back on and see that Jesus was doing Seneca and Mishpat everywhere. All over the place. All the time. Right? Jesus, like, this was his MO. Jesus said, behold, like, repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. The kingdom of God is marked by God's rule. And what is God's way in which he rules? Genesis 18:19. Yes, Seneca and Mishpat, justice and righteousness, right? What did Jesus come to bring?
Justice
and righteousness. Seneca and Mishpat. Like, that is what he came to bring. That is the reign of God. That is the kingdom of God. Right? And that's everything. Go read the Sermon on the Mount again. Matthew 5, 6, and 7. The Sermon on the Mount is Jesus' kingdom manifesto. It's like, this is life in the kingdom. This is how we do it. Right? And it's talking all about right relationships with people. Right? It's talking all about treating people justly in a biblical sense and having righteousness. So I don't think it was something brand new that came just out of nowhere because the Spirit of God now dwelt in them. I think it's something that the apostles saw Jesus doing and carried the torch forward and were just teaching it and living it and breathing it among the people. And it became so incredibly natural for them to do it because it was the culmination of where the scriptures were going. It was the completion of the Israel story, right? As I read the book of Acts, that group, it says that these are diaspora Jews at the day of Pentecost, right? You guys know what the diaspora is?
Dispersion.
The dispersion, right? So, you know, Babylonian exile, all that. So there's Jews, and it says from every nation under heaven, Acts 2. It says that they are the ones who hear all of these Galilean apostles speaking different tongues, and however long you want to interpret that, there's a big scholarly debate. But whatever happened, these diaspora Jews from every nation under heaven heard the things of God being proclaimed in their own language and responded after Peter preached that Jesus is now the way that you call on the name of Yahweh. Right? And they are all filled with the Spirit of God. I read that as the reunification of Israel. Right? It says Jews from every nation under heaven. Right? These are Jews from every nation, from every tribe who have been brought back together. This is the reunification of Israel. And so now we have Israel here carrying on the message of Jesus, and we see Israel. Again, because the early church in Jerusalem, was it comprised of Jews or Gentiles?
Jews.
Who's the first Gentile clearly saved in the book of Acts?
Cornelius.
What chapter?
10.
10. Good job. Ethiopian? Maybe. I don't know. Clearly, it's Cornelius, though. So realize, this is all Jews. This is all Israelites. And they are living out the way of Yahweh because of Jesus. Like, they're living out tzedakah and mishpat, justice and righteousness. It is so, it's such a beautiful picture. They are living out what God had intended for his people to do from day one, right? And so it's not something new, to get back to your question. I don't think it's something new. I think it's something that they were turned on to, and it's something that they naturally did because it was in their minds. And now that it's, like, naturally in our minds because I'm showing you, like, it should be something that should flow out of us. It's something that we should care about. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, you want to talk about, like this act of, like, we're talking about, like, the selling of their homes, right? Mm-hmm. Like, that being, like, the ultimate expression of
I mean, I don't know that I would say that.
That's what I'm wondering.
Like, that's, it's Luke's ultimate.
Like, so how, because, like, I don't have a home to sell. But how do we do
what
that?
What you got, bro? You can speak.
How do we do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, dude. I mean, I'm no pro at it, bro. Like, and to be perfectly honest, like, I don't have it figured out, and I really don't. Hold on, one second, I'll get to you, bro. But you know, and like, I hate, God, dude. You guys are getting such a terrible picture of me. I hate when teachers use themselves as, like, the hero example. So, like, I just don't have anything better to do. So, I'm scattering, and I'm going to talk about myself. So, I'm sorry. you know, but my wife was in, like, a super gnarly accident last year. Like, really, really bad. Guy was passing around a blind corner on the highway, on Highway 38, going up the mountain, going 70, tweaking out on that. And my wife was 135, coming out of the turn, and he hit her dead on. And, you know, she broke her collarbone, her sister broke her back and totaled the car, guy died, wasn't wearing a seatbelt, super gnarly. And we got some insurance money, you know, for it. And right away, that insurance money, I mean, it's paid two people's rent. It's helped, you know, countless people, I don't want to say how many, but, like, all of a sudden, God gave us means, and we're like, who can we help? You know what I mean? Like, yeah, we had to pay stuff off. We had to assume debt. You know what I mean? Like, student loan debt. Like, we had to do stuff with it. And you know, I feel like we've been relatively smart with it for our future, but also like we set a number and said this will go to help people. God bring us people that we need help. You know what I mean? Like that's being biblically justice minded. That's set a kind of mishpat, you know? Like we want to open our house as much as we can. We want to feed people. Like I'm in college, you know, an old pastor, dude. Like those kids got no money. I'm like, come over for dinner, dude. Like Barrett, how many times have you been to my house? You know what I mean? Like we open up our home as much as possible and try and provide. Like we have so many leaders, we have so many kids who come from broken homes, and so we want to be that home for them. You know what I mean? Like the best that we can, we want to be community minded and be minded of and have the mind of like, dude, who can we bless? How can we help in whatever way we can? You know what I mean? That's my answer.
Yeah.
Is there more? Yeah. Should we do more? For sure. Will we ever arrive? I don't think so. But I want to try. You know what I mean?
Actually, that.
Okay, go on.
I was also going to respond to that as well. But I think like with that application, that it goes in so many different. It goes in countless directions.
Yeah.
Because in a way to apply it to your life, it's just really how like you know, everybody's walk is different. So the way that you can apply that will go in multiple directions. Like for example, in my personal life, I have a grandma who's disabled, and she can't do anything. And what's that idea of justice, right? Being able to do that thing to somebody that they can't do for you in return. And so what my fiance and I do back home is my grandma has the Walmart app, so she'll get her, you know, order groceries or whatever and text us and say, hey, you know, pickup is ready. We go over to Walmart, pick up her groceries, bring it home, and then put it away for her. She doesn't even lift a finger, but we do it because we love her, and that's the way of God, right?
Yeah.
Another example is this is actually a ministry of ours that her and I do, is that we get this big crate and we fill it full of goodies and snacks and things like that. So when we're driving around doing whatever and we see a homeless person,
yeah,
we take something out, we roll down the window, and we give something to that person and we pray for them.
Yeah.
That's the way we go.
Yeah.
And that, like I said, it goes in countless directions.
Yeah, even as you say that, I'm reminded our young adult community over the Christmas season, right across the street from my parents' house, is like a convalescent home, which ironically we're sitting in an old one right now. But, you know, with COVID and stuff, they got no visitors at all. There's 74 patients there. And so at our Christmas party, you know, we're hanging out, ugly sweater party, playing games, doing whatever. We had a Christmas tree and a Polaroid camera and a bunch of cards. And so we just asked people, we said, hey, just write out cards and, like, take pictures of you and your friends. And you know, just write a nice Christmas card, like, tell people how much Jesus loves them, pray for them, like, whatever. Like, a lot of these people are going to, none of them will get visitors, and a lot of them won't get anything. You know what I mean? And so, like, okay, that was such a small way, but that was us just trying to say, like, dude, we just want to do some safe image, but like, we just want to love some people. Like, they can't do anything for us, and we just want to love them. Like, while we're here to, like, have fun and celebrate Christmas, we also want to be community-minded and, like, just love people outside of the church. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Just some scripture.
Oh, hold on. Yeah, I'm going to go far.
Oh, okay. just adding on to that, like, we each have something to give, whether that's our time or money, you know, some of us, I suppose. But we each have something to give. And even like little kids, I remember going to old folks' homes when I was a little kid with my mom and telling us, she's like, you know, you guys, you don't think you have anything to give, but you can love these older people, you can sing to them, and that blesses them so immensely. And I think that just shows them Christ's love.
Totally.
Jesus said, as much as you do for the least of these,
yeah,
you're doing it for me.
That's right.
So it's just encouraging to just think of it that way. Like, oh, we might not have a house to sell and give the money away to, but we have our time. We have
something. And again, it's like, it's being community minded, right? And like we talk about so much how community is so important, right? And it is, but like, how community minded are we really?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, and go Jeremiah 29. let's just continue on with the onslaught of Bible verses. And we had like a 2-hour discussion on this in class the other day.
It's a 2-hour discussion today.
I gotta let you guys go in 20, so hopefully not. Let's see. Start. in verse 4. What's going on in Jeremiah?
This is a prophecy about exile.
Okay. So, Jeremiah, Southern Kingdom or Northern Kingdom?
Southern.
What was the Southern Kingdom called?
Judah.
What's happened to the Northern Kingdom already?
Assyria.
Carried off, right, by Assyria, 722 BC, right? So now Jeremiah is writing after Daniel was taken in 605 BC. Another group of captives was taken in, like, I think it was like 592. Now Jeremiah is writing right before the full Babylonian exile would take place, where Babylon would seize Jerusalem and overcome Jerusalem in 586 BC, right? So some have already been taken away in two different groups. That's Daniel, that's that whole group. And so the Babylonian captivity has kind of already started, but now Jeremiah is speaking about the imminent destruction of Jerusalem and what's going to take place, right? Look at verse 4. Thus says Yahweh of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who are carried away captive, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and dwell in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit, take wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters to your husbands so that they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there and not diminished. In verse 7, and seek the peace of what? The city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it. What is it?
The city.
The city, right? For in its peace you will have what?
Peace.
What does Yahweh tell his people?
Be righteous and just as that.
Pray for the government so you still have
quiet. Where are they going?
Babylon.
Babylon. So what are they to do when they're in Babylon?
Babylon.
I mean, they're to seek the peace of where?
Babylon.
They're enemy.
Right? Like they're to seek the well-being of the city that they're in. Effectively, what Yahweh is saying is the city that you're going to, Babylon, should be a better place because my people. Does it say anything? I'm just curious, okay? I'm not saying that this isn't a thing. I'm just curious. Does it say anything about them going and making proselytes in Babylon? What's a proselyte?
Jewish convert.
Does it say anything about proselytization?
No.
It doesn't. It says go and seek the well-being of the city. I think being an, again, it doesn't even say be an example. I think being an example is inherent in it. But what is Yahweh telling them to do? What?
Right.
Yeah, go thrive in the city that you're going to, and go, like, the city's going to thrive as you thrive. The city should be a better place because God's people live there. What kind of impact does that have for us today as a church, as followers of Jesus, as new humanity, animated by the Spirit of God?
America is also because we're Christian. All right. America should be a better place because we live here.
Smaller. Shrink it down.
Yeah,
Yukaipa,
should be a better place
because I'm living here. Yeah. Yukaipa, where I minister, should be a better place because there's Christians there. Right? Yucca Valley should be a better place because there's Christians here. You know what I mean? Like, and not just like morally. Like morally, yes, it should be better. Right? Because they're saying there's Christians here. Right? But we're not talking morally. Like, does anything in the context, I mean, it's talking about planting gardens and building houses. Like, are we talking morally here, or is it talking seek the well-being of the city? Right? I just, again, justice and righteousness, man. This is Yahweh's heart. He says it. This is the way of Yahweh in Genesis 18. I'm not making that up. I showed you. Right? And now we even see as his people are being carried off into exile, he is so focused on getting them to understand that. Amos, okay? Biblical chronology here. Amos, written before Jeremiah or after?
Before.
What was Yahweh's beef in Amos?
They weren't executing justice and righteousness.
Yeah, you guys are doing sitting in this spot. You're worshiping, right? You're sacrificing, you're singing, you're gathering, you're doing all that, but you're not doing justice and righteousness. Right? What, like, does he did in Amos did he sound mad or just like kind of mad or like really mad? But he sounded really mad, right? And so was it for lack of like lip service? Or was it for lack of like them actually doing it that he was mad? I mean, that was what he carried them off into exile for. And now he's telling them, as you're going into exile, go do Sitka and Mishpah in the city that you're going to. Go seek the well-being of the city. You guys suck at it right now. That's why you're leaving. But it's so important to me. Go do it again. And like, do you see the repetition? Do you see how this really is the way of Yahweh? But yet we don't talk about it. We don't do it. And really so many of our churches, and again, I'm speaking royally here, okay? American church, we exist in our four walls, and we don't exist outside of those four walls, with the exception of maybe some small groups that meet in people's houses. But are we seeking the well-being of the city beyond just preaching the gospel of personal salvation to them and saying, you can be forgiven of your sins, and then you can go live a morally righteous life with Jesus' name on it? Instead of preaching a holistic gospel, don't label me some new age crackpot, all right, when I say holistic, but realize holistic is the big picture gospel, gospel of the kingdom, that God is redeeming this world, his humans as a part of that, so that we can get back to the way that God intended for creation to operate, where we live under the rule and the reign of God. Siddika and Mishpat is lived out in our relationship with God and our relationship with one another, physically upon this earth. Dude, the gospel's a rad story, right? Like, that's the message that we have to bring to the world. We need a big picture, full-orbed reality of what the message of the Bible is about, so that we can impact this world with the gospel of the kingdom of God. Amen? Yeah.
I like the message, but it seems like you almost put us on the level of the animals. It's like the animals of the world.
No. Don't hear that. Because realize, the animals, I mean, we started off saying that we were created in the image of God.
Yeah.
That who does God desire to rule the world through?
Us.
I mean, it's us.
He puts, I love you saying that he put us as
his images.
Images.
So yeah.
That we can, everyone can know that he reigns.
But who else?
Everyone else.
Everything.
Who else?
All creation.
That's a great question.
Oh, man.
That's not open that can of worms,
though.
You want to open a can of worms? I have no idea. There are some theories out there, and I'm not saying I believe any of these, but they're really interesting to think through, that the cosmic war of good and evil is a lot bigger than we realize.
Oh, yeah.
And that, creation on God's part. Again, I'm not saying I believe this. I'm just saying this is a theory that's out there. That is just interesting to think through. That creation, the act of creation itself on God's part, and creating humanity as his image-bearing humans and setting them all throughout the world so that it marks the place where his rule and reign is experienced, where Siddika and Mishpat is done, right, was an act of war against the evil forces of wickedness. An act of war and saying, like, this is the place where my rule and reign is going to be experienced. I know there's so many questions.
Yeah.
And I'm not telling you I have the answer. Like, I'm just saying, like, what you asked, I'm with you, bro.
Like, as
I'm just trying to figure it out.
You say if that theory is true, is what you're saying is that there was God and there was evil. You know, it's like saying two things existed. And like, for me, I think God defined evil. Through his attributes, he defined evil. And and like, you see that through the law. And
okay, so what do you do with the mysterious talking serpent in Genesis chapter 3?
The mysterious, you mean Satan?
I mean, if you're saying that there was no evil before creation, then what do you do with the mysterious talking serpent? Should you even realize, why is there a freaking animal talking?
Yeah.
It's just stuff that we just move right past in the Bible, dude. Like, that bothers me.
Well, is the...
Listen, I'm not telling you I have the answer.
But, like, isn't the serpent a representation of Satan? If it's not Satan, then who's...
Oh, I totally think it's Satan. I mean, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 3, I think he calls it, he says he is the Satan, right? He is Satan.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm not saying that. He's mysterious. Where the heck did he come from? Right? We're not giving any information. All of a sudden, there's just this animals talking, like tempting them to go against Yahweh. The Bible is not as nice and neat as we pretend it is. Like, there is so many loopholes and, like, open-ended questions and plot holes, you know, is what we call those things.
Really, we can see that Satan has power. We can see that in Exodus, where the other staffs turn into snakes, too, when they throw down their staffs, and we can see that there's demonic power. So, I mean, the serpent.
Satan at the time.
Right. So, but what I'm trying to get you to see is that is infant creation. Things are as God wants it to be. He placed humanity there as his image-bearing covenant partners to rule and reign over creation on his behalf. Said, go make a beautiful world out of this place. Trust my definition of good and evil. And then all of a sudden, the representation of evil is already there.
So
where did evil come from?
So it's saying, so it's saying that evil's always been there. Yeah. Not that been there?
I have no idea.
But there was
something that puts God in evil painful.
Listen, I'm not telling you that I have the answer. I'm just telling you, I'm trying to make sense of it too. Like, where did it come from? We're not told.
Well, another thing for me is, like, I believe that God is, there's nothing above God, so I don't think evil is Palestine. I think God defined good, and that defined evil.
So, I mean, have you read Isaiah 14, Ezekiel 28, the fall of the king of Tyre? Most theologians think that that's speaking of Lucifer, right? Lucifer as, kind of this archangel type figure. I will ascend to the throne of the Most High, right? That is like the satanic rebellion. A bunch of the demons going, a bunch of the angels, fallen angels going with him. So, I mean, when did that happen?
Like, my question's always been like, we have pastors come and they tell us, like, man, there's a new earth, there's going to be a new earth, there's a new Jerusalem, a new heaven. It's that talk over here, and they're trying to be sin. But then I'm like, well, then how did they sin at the beginning? Like, what's to say that we won't sin in the eternal kingdom of God?
I have a
theory. Or someone won't sin in the
eternal
kingdom.
Well, also realize Revelation 21, 22 comes after Revelation 20. I know that's very insightful. but realize what happens in Revelation 20 is sin and death thrown into Hades in like a fire, right? So, I mean, it's ultimately judged. Then in Revelation 21, you have the New Jerusalem coming out of heaven here, adorned like a bride for her husband,
so
right?
Yeah. So then if we're looking as us and this world being the representation of where God rules and reigns, is that more for the eternal kingdom rather than now because we're so sinful?
Well, again, it's now spiritually because the Spirit of God lives in us, right? We're a part of new creation now. We talked about that earlier. So it's the already, it's the not yet, right? We already live in God's kingdom, but it's not yet physically manifesting, right?
Yeah.
But getting back to, what's your name again?
David.
Okay. I'm with you. It bothers you. It bothers me. Like we don't talk about it. Where did evil come from?
But
when did that rebellion take place?
Yeah,
that rebellion take place?
Yeah, I have no idea.
But I have a theory to tell you. It's a weird ordeal of God's creation. Essentially, like you said, that God's creation essentially said, no, I'm God. The only thing you kind of could really do is put yourself over God at that time. God's
right.
Like, no, that's not right. I am God. I am everything. I created you. What do you think? So I think, so you get down to this, you have to really think of the vastness of God and get down to, what if the story's not about God redeeming the entire earth, but what if it's about God fulfilling his perfect creation? Like, what if he allowed us to fall so we had a kingdom of people that chose him as their God?
See, but now you're getting into like the fundamentalism of Adam and Eve's choice. You don't think that, and I'm just pressing you on this, okay?
I mean,
and I'm sure someone else here is thinking the same thing. You don't think that Adam's and Eve's kids would have to make the same choice that Adam and Eve did?
Or
do you think Adam and Eve made a once for all choice?
I think, we see in Romans 5:18 that grace in that. But I think it showed the flaw in man, and God said, okay, that's the flaw in man, and now we're going to work it out. And I think the redemption.
So God caused the fall.
God didn't cause it, but he sure did allow it. He could have stopped it if he wanted to. Why would a tree there? Why would he even make Satan?
We talked about that last week. The tree was representative of the choice to trust Yahweh or not trust Yahweh.
Yeah.
Right? They chose don't trust Yahweh. And that has ruined humanity since, right? And so, yes, God launched the plan that he already knew he was going to do, right? But he launched the plan, Genesis 3:15, for the new human to come and accomplish all that Adam failed to do, right? But as I'm looking at it, you think, I'm just pressing you on this. If Adam and Eve had chosen to trust Yahweh and not eat of the fruit, You don't think that every human from that point on would have had to make the same choice?
Well, the truth is still better.
I think so.
So, but yeah.
So because you just said earlier, and again, I'm pressing you. You said that Yahweh allowed it so that there would be a whole generation of Christians who chose Him. But I would submit to you that the way the narrative reads is that everyone would have had to make that choice, right? You know what I mean? So listen, we're getting into the infinite mind of God.
I see what you mean now, because you're saying even after that, we would still have to continue to.
Like, at one point, you would have still had to choose to open the tree.
But we appreciate
God's mercy that we fell down.
It is God's mercy.
It's mercy.
I mean, so now we're getting into a very big revisionist history thing, but I love it. Would we appreciate God as much? I think so. We'd be living in creation the way that it was meant to be experienced. Yeah. What's our hope for the future? Creation the way that it was meant to be experienced. You know what I mean? Like, we'd be living in a world where we're living in partnership with God, where heaven and earth are united and overlapping. God's presence is here upon the earth, and we're living in peace and harmony, justice and righteousness, and all, like, we're living life the way that it was meant to be experienced.
But
like, we are living a shadow of the existence that we were meant to live.
Adam and Eve didn't appreciate God. That's why they didn't treat
it. Well, they didn't trust God. They made the decision not to trust
Him. They decided that they were really
good. Okay, so how about this? Maybe we rock it a little bit more. Listen. Okay, seriously.
I would hate that.
I'm really sorry that I'm going to do this to you.
Please.
I hope you know what I was thinking today.
Go to Genesis 2. And I only have a couple minutes. If you hate this, I'm so sorry. Genesis 2. Okay, first thing we have to understand, Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning God created the what?
Heavens and the earth.
That Hebrew word heavens always refers to skies. Okay? We got to get the idea of heaven was created. Get that out of there. Okay? The word itself means skies. Notice in the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, heavens is always plural. Never occurs singular. There is no singular word in Hebrew for heaven. Okay? It's heavens. Literally refers to the sky. Earth, the word earth, refers to land every other time that it's translated. Right? So literally what Genesis 1 means is that God created the skies and the land. Right? And then he goes into verse 2 and says the Spirit hovered over what?
Waters,
right? So then you get the picture. Okay, there was water, Spirit was there. The word is ruach in Hebrew, which literally means breath or wind, means spirit too, depending on how it's translated. But then it tells us the God put land on the waters, right? And separated, okay, that whole picture. Okay, so that's important for us to understand. So there's land. Okay, now coming into the Genesis 2 narrative, look at verse 8. The Lord God planted a garden eastward in where?
Eden.
And there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made every tree grow that is pleasant to sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now a river went out of Eden to water the what?
Garden.
The garden, and from there it parted and became four river heads. Okay, and then it tells us what the name of these rivers are. All right. It tells us in verse 15, then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend and to keep it. All right, so let me ask you guys a question. Where is Eden? Like, so, let me rephrase the question. Is the garden Eden?
No.
Or is the garden in Eden?
In garden in Eden.
Eden. Where does it say that?
Nowhere.
Look.
In Eden. It says in Eden.
In
Eden.
So, the garden is not Eden.
Right.
Eden is a place. Eden is a territory, let's say that, right? Eden's a territory. So where's the garden?
In Eden.
In Eden. Right? But all of Eden, is it a garden?
No.
No, the garden's in Eden. Right? So, Genesis 4. I know, I'm messing with you. I hate it. Sorry. It sucks. I'm telling you, just read over stuff. It's there, right? So, Genesis 4, Cain murders Abel, right?
Yeah.
Cain murders Abel. And God removes Cain from where?
In the garden.
Eden.
In Eden.
The garden in Eden.
People will kill me.
Oh, what does he say, Max?
They're going to kill me.
Who's going to kill him?
But where is that? What does it say he's going
to
kill me?
Go to, go to 4. Flip over to 4.
What verse?
Go to 4.
Zach.
Genesis 4.
As far as verse.
Here we go, here we go. Verse.
Hold on 1 second. Let me find it.
Hold on.
14.
Go to 11. So now you are cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand, right after you kill him. You will till the ground, and shall no longer yield its strength to you. A fugitive and vagabond you shall be on the earth. And Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Surely you have driven me out of this day from the face of the ground. I shall be hidden from your face. Where was God's presence?
In Eden
or in the garden?
In the garden.
In the garden, right? Adam and Eve, were they removed from the garden or were they removed from Eden?
The garden.
What did Cain and Abel do that stirred on this whole jealousy thing between them? What was the act that they did? They came
off
the ground. Okay. The way that I read it, it makes sense that this is temple imagery here, right? Think Holy of Holies is the inner place of God's presence. What's the garden? It's the inner place in what area?
Eden.
Literally said the garden was in Eden, right? So there's land. Well, technically there's water. There's land. There's Eden. Then there's what? Garden. What's at the center of the garden?
Two trees.
Tree of life. Tree of knowledge of good and evil, right? So think temple. Think big picture temple. Solomon's temple, right? We have court of the Gentiles. We have what? We have inner court, right? Or sorry, court of the women, inner court. Then we have what?
The Holy of Holies.
What was woven into the tapestry of the veil that was there?
Cherubim.
What guarded the access to the garden?
Cherubim.
What was placed in the Holy of Holies?
The cherubim, the ark.
What else? No, in the Holy of Holies in the temple.
Ark
of the Covenant. What else?
Oh, the staff and
the rod. Oh, the thing with the
menorah. The menorah, a figurative tree of life.
Right.
Right. Are we picking up on it?
Yes.
Are we picking up on it? You get it?
Yeah.
Okay. Why don't we read the Bible this way? Listen, serious question. Why don't we read the Bible this way? Because we're in such a hurry to get through these passages. Right? So, I know that answers nothing for you. But listen.
What are you talking about again?
Okay, here we go. Read verse 14 though with me. Sorry, I got distracted. Okay. Middle of verse 14, Cain says, I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth, again on the land, because he was kicked out of Eden. Right? I believe, this is just how I read it, seeing that like tiered kind of cosmology, temple picture. What I see is Cain and Abel offering sacrifices at the entrance to the Holy of Holies.
So at the entrance of Eden.
Right. At the entrance to the garden. So they're in Eden offering sacrifices at the entrance to the garden. Where God's presence is, aka Holy of Holies. Right? Right? So listen. So now they're being driven, now he's being driven out of Eden. He's already been out of the garden. That happened with Adam and Eve. Right? Again, the cherubim's the thing that clinches it for me. Right? I'm like, oh, there's cherubim on the veil, all of that, right? So now he's driven out of Eden. Look at this. He says, I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond on the what?
Earth.
On the earth. I told you that word means land. Okay, so now he's outside of Eden, and it will happen that anyone who finds me will kill me. What? Now there's people outside of Eden? Where did that come in? close your Bibles. I'm saying, listen. There is so much. Listen.
What is this special teaching?
There is so much. There's so much that we don't know. There is so much that we don't have a picture of. But here's what we do know. Okay, listen to what we do know. I don't want to just leave you with a bomb saying you know nothing. Here's what we do know. All right, is we know that God created this world. He created this world teeming with beauty. Yes, wild, but with untapped potential. And he put his image here upon this earth. He told that image to be fruitful, to be productive, right? To multiply, to make more image-bearing humans, to fill the earth with those image-bearing humans, and to subdue the earth. Remember the word that we talked about last week, kalash, right? To go impose upon the earth your will so that it will do for you what it won't want to do naturally. Go build something beautiful. Go build a world. Sports and music and entertainment and cities and music and culture and art and all of this beautiful stuff. And my image-bearing humans are going to have justice and righteousness and fairness and love and equity be the thing that marks their dealings with one another and their dealings with me. And yet that perfect, beautiful picture of creation, the image that God had, was stained and ruined by sin. And from that moment forward, everything is about getting back to that picture.
Getting back to the garden.
By means of getting back to the garden, but it's not a garden. In Genesis 21 and 22, what is it?
A city.
It's a city. To steal John Mark Comer's title, it's a garden city. Where's the tree of life at, Revelation 22?
In the midst of the New
Jerusalem.
Yeah, it's in the midst of the New Jerusalem, right in the middle of the center. Right, there's rivers flowing out of it. Where were there rivers flowing out of in the first two, couple pages of the Bible? Genesis 2, right? It said it flowed out of the garden, right? I mean, it's us getting back to the garden. And that is why this is all so vitally important. Did Jesus die for your sin? Yeah, he did, and it's a beautiful message. But let's make sure that we don't make that the only message that we preach. Because Jesus died for sin, not just your sin. Jesus died for sin, so that sin would be eradicated from God's beautiful, beautiful world. So that humanity could live in partnership with God, ruling and reigning over his creation like he intended from the beginning. So everything that we don't know, there's a lot. As you study the Bible more and more, you're going to realize there's just a lot of stuff you don't know. It's actually really unfortunate. It's kind of this like catch 22 thing, you know. But you got to keep it in picture, dude. Realize that God has launched this redemption plan, and it's so vitally important for us. So we talked about the fivefold breakdown of the gospel, right? That was literally the slide that started us on this whole thing. What was the fivefold breakdown of the gospel? Creation, fall, Israel, redemption, restoration. Let's preach them all. Amen.
Amen.
Guys. Real quick, I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I know you guys got served at 3:30. I'm available to chat. My number's in the syllabus. If you want to text me or call me or whatever, I'd love to chat with you and try to do whatever I can. So
Is it like something like a book? We could read alongside the Bible. Because, like, there's no way, I'm telling you, there's no way I'm going to pull that out on my own Bible study.
He
opened the Bible.
The only books that I'm gonna recommend to you are all they're going to do is tell you to read the Bible carefully. Right. Like, everything, I hope you see that everything I've told you today is the Bible.
Right,
yeah. Like, it's all right there. And hopefully, I did a good job setting everything in context for you. Right? So I want you to see that it's there. And so, you know, yeah, like, I mean, the Bible Project is phenomenal at this. Tim Mackey's a wizard. He's got his PhD in Old Testament. Like, he's phenomenal at reading details like this. There's an incredible book that I read last semester. It's called Who Shall Ascend the Mountain of the Lord? It's in the New Studies of Biblical Theology series. It's very dense, but it's a biblical theology of Leviticus. And a lot of this cosmology, the garden, creation as archetypal temple, figurative kind of stuff, came from that. It's a guy named Michael Morales, PhD in Pentateuchal studies, and it's very, very, very good. But he gets into Day of Atonement stuff and all that. It's phenomenal. There's a lot of stuff out there, but listen, here's my challenge to you. Don't stop reading the Bible. Like read the Bible, but read the Bible without your Western 21st century mindset, and ask questions. You know what I mean? Like, this stuff is there. You just gotta ask questions, and don't just breeze over it. Like, I don't know. Sometimes I'll just sit down and read the first three chapters of Genesis and just be like, I'm so mad because there's so much that I don't understand. You know, I'm like, I'll just ask God, like, show me something new. You know, like, and this is what your life pursuit of studying and teaching the Bible. This is the kind of stuff that you're signing up for, because there's so much that we don't know. You know, and all of this, and I prayed this at the beginning, and I'm gonna pray that rest again here in a minute. If I ever stop talking. This all needs to be put in perspective of ministering and loving on people and sharing the gospel of the kingdom of God with people. You know, and this isn't just some like academic pursuit of just trying to learn and know. This is in my mind, I want to know this stuff because this is who God is. And I want to be able to accurately portray who my God is to the people that I'm speaking to about him. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So for me, this is not wrapped up and I just got to know. For me, this is wrapped up and I just got to know him. Mm-hmm. And I think that we need to root it and ground it in that reality. Amen? Amen. All right, let me pray for us. Lord, I just commit this group to you. Just thankful for some time today to talk about so much, but Lord, so much just biblical theology, just God, who you are. Lord, it's just even just thinking about A.W. Tozer's book, Knowledge of the Holy, the opening line just says, what comes into our mind when we think of God is the most important thing about us. And this is the reality for us, God. This is why theology is so important. We want to know you. We want to know your heart. We want to know your desire. We want to know your plan for your creation, for humanity, for the restoration. God, we want to know what your heart is for what we're facing in our culture, for this just divisive, polarized culture that we live in. God, give us wisdom. Help us as we know you, as we walk with you, as we seek to follow your way. Lord, even as we just kind of been turned on to Tzedakah and Mishpat and justice and righteousness, give us wisdom. God, you know how hard. I know that I have not figured this out, but I definitely have had my eyes turned on to some things that I've just been missing. God, I want to honor you. I want to be what you're about. And God, I pray that for these students as well here today. And God, I pray that above all, we would know you. I think of Paul's fivefold goal that he mentions in Philippians 3:10, the first of which he says, I want to know him. God, help us to know you. You have given us this incredible book. A book that, yes, has an impact upon our life, but ultimately is not about us. It's about you. It's about your heart and your plan, the kind of God that you are. And so, God, help us to know you as we study your word. We love you, Jesus. Commit ourselves to you in the mighty name of our Messiah King, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.